You know what I say to people? I say I don't do yoga, I make bread. I don't really like yoga that much, but I really like making bread, and I do feel like bread making is meditative, truly. Wow, sorry, we're going real deep here. This is maybe deeper than we need to go. Hey everyone, I'm Claire Saffitz, and today is a special day because I am going to show you probably my favorite thing to make and bake of all time, and that is sourdough bread. Sourdough bread baking is really more of a method and a technique rather than a recipe. I can't think of anything that's more satisfying to make. You, on the one hand, feel accomplished that you have created this thing where you've harnessed this sort of life force that just exists all around us. And then on top of that, you then get to eat sourdough and like the most delicious bread ever. Sourdough is a paradox because it's simultaneously very simple and very complex. The real heart of the matter is that sourdough is a naturally leavened bread, and that natural leavening comes from something called starter. So starter, at its core, is basically a mixture of flour and water that has been inoculated with all of these different kinds of yeast and bacteria that just naturally occur everywhere. So there's naturally occurring yeast and bacteria all around us. It's on surfaces, it's on plants, it's in the air that we breathe. And naturally leavened bread, or sourdough, is bread that uses those natural yeast and bacteria rather than commercial yeast. We don't need that. Get that away. Starter is fascinating. It is the life force of your bread. At this stage in a COVID landscape, you probably know someone that has starter. So ask around for your friends. Like, people are always trying to give it away because they're having to feed it once a week. And once you have it, it's very easy to maintain. So when you have starter, you have all these yeast and bacteria that are living in this mixture of flour and water, and they are feeding on the carbohydrates in the flour, and they're breaking it down into sugars, and they are metabolizing that and then producing gas as a byproduct. Eventually, those yeast and bacteria will run out of food, so you have to feed your starter. It's like having a very low maintenance pet. All you have to do is feed it once a week. Now, for most home bakers, keeping your starter in the fridge makes the most sense because those yeast and bacteria are temperature sensitive. You'd be keeping it in your fridge because presumably you're not baking every single day. You don't really want to use starter right out of the fridge for baking bread because you want those yeast and bacteria to have a chance to enliven and grow and sort of become really active. I'm only going to be taking 25 grams of this and feeding it again. If you've picked sort of the day of the week where you want to do the majority of the work, the day before, you're gonna pull your starter out of the fridge in the morning, feed it, obviously returning the rest of it to the fridge, then feed it one more time in the evening, and then by the next morning, hopefully, the idea is that it will have reached this sort of ideal level of activity, and then you can start mixing your dough. Here I have the same starter, but it's in three different stages of ripeness. So this is a starter I just fed. It's thick and a little lumpy. This is starter that I fed last night, and it has just come up to sort of this point of ideal ripeness. This starter has gone way beyond that point. It rose, got all super bubbly, and then it collapsed. And now it's like super liquidy, it smells really sour. I can still feed it and continue to use it, but this is really beyond the point at which I want to use it for making bread. I have neglected my starter at home for, I'm embarrassed to say, maybe not months. Definitely several weeks. There's nothing wrong with it. As long as you don't have mold growing on it and like you'll know what that looks like, your starter is salvageable. I've never named it. The name of it is starter. While I wait for my starter to ripen, I'm going to do a step called Autolyse. It is a step that is going to help us to develop right at the start a lot of gluten. If starter is the life force, then gluten is the backbone. You need gluten to like trap the gases and to create this beautiful, chewy, airy structure to your bread. We're using 1,000 grams of flour total, and that will make 2 loaves because like you're gonna go through quite a long process. You're gonna want at least 2 loaves of bread at the end. We know that we want a lot of gluten in our bread. That means using white bread flour, which has high protein content for the gluten, but we also want really good flavor. Whole grain flours, which have less protein proportionate to white flour, contribute great flavor. Hydration is the term for the proportion of water to flour. If I have 1,000 grams of flour and 750 grams of water, then I have a 75% hydration dough. It's just like one over the other. This is a really important tool. I'm using a bowl scraper here. When you're bread baking, this is a pretty indispensable tool. It really functions as an extension of your hand and it helps you to work more cleanly. So you're not getting like tons of sticky, wet dough on your hand. The goal here is just to get all of the flour hydrated, but I don't have to really mix it. I'm not trying to work it really. I'll cover this with a damp towel and then this will just hang out. Like it doesn't have the starter in it yet. Nothing's gonna really happen. It's just that all of that gluten is starting to form. And then when the starter is ready, we're gonna add it to the dough. Okay, my dough has been in Autolyse for about an hour. I can tell that my starter is at that maximum ripeness stage. So you can see I have tape that I put on there when I fed it. The height has basically doubled. Another sign is I have all of these bubbles on top. This is when all of those yeast and bacteria are at their liveliest. When you add them to the bread dough, they are like at their full potential to really raise the bread. There's another test though, to see if it's ready. It's called the float test. So this is a test you can use to guarantee that you are using your starter at the kind of optimal point. So I have a bowl of just room temperature tap water here. And I'm just gonna pinch off a little piece of starter and put it in the bowl and I wanna see if it floats. It's floating, it did not sink to the bottom. And that means the starter has all this air in it and it's really at that optimal point where we wanna add it to our flour and water mixture. If your starter sinks and you know it's not ready yet, go ahead, put the lid back on, let it sit until it passes a float test, and you should really do the test like every 30 minutes or so. But when you start to see lots of teeming bubbles and like it looks super airy, that's when you're probably right at that point. And you can see that as this has sat, look at what has happened to the texture. So this is the purpose of Autolyse, is to develop tons and tons of gluten in advance of adding everything else. So now we're gonna add the starter to this. There's a particular technique that I like to use for incorporating starter into the Autolyse. And it's just this like lobster claw pinching method. So this just helps to incorporate things of two different textures. Sourdough bread is more of a practice than anything else. The amount of learning that you do from loaf 1 to loaf 50 to loaf 100 to loaf 200 is like it never ends. I'm sure I'm gonna get questions from people about like, can I just do this in a stand mixer? And the answer is yes, you could, but I don't use it for making sourdough. The primary reason is that it's important for me to be able to gauge its development, to have a sense of what's happening. I think feeling the dough is part of that process. Now I'm going to add my salt. I'm using kosher salt. The most important thing is that you weigh the salt just as you've done for every other component. I have 20 grams, so it's 2% salt. That's sort of a standard ratio. And now I like to add a little bit of extra water when I incorporate the salt because it just helps to work it into the dough more easily. I remember my first sourdough loaf. It was so sad, you guys. It was so, so sad. It seriously looked like a flying saucer. It like somehow baked really flat, but like the bottom curved up. It looked crazy. It looked like a UFO. My roommate came in and was like, what is that? I was like, it's bread. And she was like, really? The answer was no, it wasn't really bread. And that was like with starter that I made myself and I had no idea what I was doing. And I didn't understand sourdough the way I understand it now, which is that it is a practice. Like you can't go on autopilot when you're trying to make it. I just didn't know what I was doing. And I didn't know what I didn't know. Okay, so I have all of the salt incorporated. I'm gonna do the next step, which is mixing, but first I wanna let this just hang out in the bowl, and I want some of that extra water that we added to absorb. I want the gluten to like relax a little bit, so I'm just gonna set my damp towel back on top, and just 10 minutes, and I'm gonna come back, and we're gonna do the next stage, which is mixing. After a brief rest, I am ready to mix this dough. This mixing technique is very simple. We're keeping everything inside the bowl. I'm gonna lift up and fold it back down into the dough. So I'm folding it up and then over onto itself and kind of pressing down. Also, now that we've added the starter, we sort of officially entered this stage called bulk fermentation, where now that the starter is in there, it's beginning to feed on all that new flour that it's coming into contact with. Could you do this in a stand mixer? Yes. Is it a lot easier? Yes. Is there something that I like about playing with the dough at this stage? Yes. Like, I think the goal for a first loaf is just like, have it be enjoyable to eat, if not perfect, and like you want it to just be good enough that you want to make it again, really. That's kind of the goal. That's my personal goal for this recipe, is like just to get people into the practice of it. It's certainly unrealistic to think that anyone's gonna get like a tartine level loaf of bread from their first bake, but as long as it sparks the interest in one day getting a tartine level loaf, then it's mission accomplished. So after 10 minutes of mixing, I'm gonna do the window pane test. Pinch off maybe about a golf ball size piece of dough. I'm gonna work it outward in all directions. One thing that will indicate whether or not I've built sufficient strength in the dough, is if I can get the dough into a thin layer that is in fact so thin that light will pass through. And that's the sort of where the name window pane comes from. So if it tears, I'm not there yet and I want to keep mixing. It's not the best window pane, but it's all that we need. We are ready to let this dough basically rise. Bakers call it bulk fermentation. So it's during bulk fermentation that the lactic acid bacteria that's in your starter is producing acids that are creating the sour flavor. The yeast is releasing gases, and that's getting trapped by the gluten that we just developed. So then you're gonna have all these like big airy holes. And so we wanna let that do its thing, and we're gonna come back basically every hour and take a look and do some folds. So this is our dough that has been in bulk fermentation for about an hour. It's very possible that you'll see some bubbles forming, but mostly what you'll notice is that the dough has gone really slack. We wanna build strength throughout the bulk fermentation process by doing a series of these folds. And similar to the motion that I used for mixing the dough, I'm gonna slide my hand down alongside the bowl, lift it up, this time being a little more gentle, and then laying it back down on top of itself. Then I give a 90 degree turn, and then same thing, lifting up. This is stretching the dough, helping to reform and reconnect those chains of gluten. And now last one on the fourth side. So now I'm gonna cover it, and this is bulk fermentation. I'm just gonna come back basically every hour, check on it, see what's happening, gauge how it's rising, and do those folds. This has been sitting for another hour after that first fold, so 2 hours total in bulk fermentation, and it's time to do another fold. I can see that there is some air in the dough. It's looking really good. So again, I wanna do this gently because I don't wanna deflate any gases that have built up, but I can feel that it feels more aerated. It's lighter in texture. There are some big air bubbles in there. That's what we want. So now another hour, we'll come back and do it a third time. There's a range for bulk fermentation. Given the factors of temperature and starter and flours and all that, it could be anywhere from like 4 to 7 hours. This is why this is sort of an all-day process. It's like, it's not super hands-on. You can go do other things, but you do want to come back and check on it every so often. Another way you can do it is actually using both hands to sort of reach down underneath the dough and fold it onto itself a couple times. If you're more comfortable, just do that sort of one-handed, four sides of the bowl kind of thing. Long bulk fermentation, it's a little cool in here, but we're finally ready to move on to the next stage of the process, which is forming and shaping our loaves and setting them up for proof. And we should just all pause for a moment to be grateful at the incredible transformation of this dough. I would say this has basically doubled in volume. This bread feels super aerated, almost whipped. And so this is how I know that we're done with bulk fermentation. Okay, so here's what we wanna do. I wanna get this dough divided into two pieces into these baskets. I'm gonna dust the surface with a little bit of flour. This is actually a 50-50 mix of rice flour and regular wheat flour. Rice flour is good because there's less sticking. It doesn't absorb liquid the way that wheat flour does, and so it tends to do a better job at like protecting the basket liners and just not having anything stick to the surface. So I have a little wand here for dusting. You don't need this. You could just do this, you know, on your surface, which is great. But this does help. And now I'm gonna let the dough sort of pull itself out of the bowl. I don't wanna pop a lot of any of the air bubbles that we worked so hard to develop. So I'm gonna try to work quickly. It's good to use like decisive motions at this stage, but I'm just going to divide the dough. Oh my God, it's so sticky. Try to separate them because they will start to like fuse back together. I am going to do a step called pre-shaping, which is getting them into like a more organized sort of little nice packet. And basically I'm just gonna gather all the edges of the dough and bring them toward the center to try to make something that's sort of round in shape. I'm gonna dust it with a little more flour. And what I'm doing is just tucking the ends of the dough underneath and getting it to kind of sit in this tight round shape. So that's one side pre-shaped. I'm gonna do the other side. Really the main thing is you wanna be gentle because I don't want to like squish the dough and pop all those bubbles and everything. So here I have my two pre-shaped halves. So I'm gonna let them rest for about 15 minutes. One step I'll do really quickly is just to dust my proofing baskets. I want to flour these generously so that I don't have a lot of sticking inside the baskets themselves. So these baskets are called banneton. These are very, very convenient. They help to give a very nice, even, regular shape to the dough. You don't need the banneton, but I do recommend. So you can see that after it's rested, they've sort of like relaxed a little bit and they've widened and gotten a little more squat. So these are in a good place to shape. Shaping is hard. The dough is sticky. When you watch someone who's really good at it and it doesn't stick to their hands, it gives you a false sense of your own ability, but like it's hard. So I'm gonna try to flip it over in one motion. I sort of tug outward to elongate it, and now I'm gonna basically kind of fold it like a present, like one side in, other side in. If you need to, you can give it like a little pinch to get it to stick. I'm gonna start at the end closest to me and roll it up like a jelly roll. I'm gonna now transfer it to my basket. This part, again, kind of dicey, but like the shaping takes a lot of practice. If you feel like you don't nail it on your first try, it might mean that your loaf doesn't have that beautiful classic loaf shape, but it's still gonna taste great. And as long as you're trying to maintain a lot of the air in it, you're good. So just like that, and into the basket seam side up. I can give a little more flour on top, and I'll set this aside while I do the other piece. What you're trying to achieve with shaping is you are trying to create tension in the dough. You are basically trying to stretch the dough across the surface around itself. And that tension is what is going to help your loaves rise up and out and get this beautiful oven spring. There's one final step called proofing. Proofing is kind of like the second rise that occurs after the loaves have been shaped. I'm gonna let them proof at room temp. I'm gonna cover these and just set them aside, and then we'll come back and take a look at them after they've proofed. We've been here all day. I know it's a process, we're so close. So we're gonna do the final test to see if the loaves are proofed. What I'm looking for is a sign that the dough has relaxed. And so when I poke my finger in, all those chains of gluten are gonna wanna make the dough spring back, but I want it to spring back slowly. So if you push your finger in and it springs back quickly, it's not proofed yet, let it go a little longer. So now, these are proofed, the dough feels great, it feels super light and airy, it's nice and relaxed, and now they just need to go in the fridge. One of the things I really like about sourdough is these go into the fridge and you can bake them after 8 hours in the fridge or 48 hours in the fridge. So for the next couple days, these can just be hanging out in your fridge, ready to be baked whenever you feel like it. I just wanna say, we're at the most exciting stage of the whole thing, which is baking the loaves. This is the part that gets my heart a little aflutter. I like get excited and nervous at the same time, even after so many years of sourdough baking at home, just because it's so exciting and every loaf of bread is like a snowflake. Each one is unique. It's so exciting to see how they turn out. So I have my Dutch oven preheating. And we're gonna bake from cold. You don't wanna let your loaves come up to room temperature because in the long run, you know, baking in a 500 degree oven, 40 degrees here and there isn't gonna make much of a difference. Also, it's a lot easier to handle the dough when it's still cold. Dust the surface of the dough because this side is gonna be the side it's in contact with the Dutch oven, and I don't want it to stick. Now, I use parchment paper to help me transfer the dough from the surface into the super hot Dutch oven, and it just feels like less dicey, but I'm gonna slowly peel it off. You don't have to dust with flour at this stage, but I do like having the contrast in the surface. And now I'm gonna use something called a lame. Lame just means blade in French. It's basically a razor blade on a little handle. But I find I have more control just by doing it like this. There's all sorts of elaborate scoring methods that you can use. For beginners, I recommend just a single lengthwise slash. Now slashing just gives the bread dough a means of expanding in a predictable way. If I didn't slash it, the bread would still rise, but it would sort of crack and like fissure at places, you know, and it just doesn't look as good. I'm gonna quickly go up and in. The lid goes on. I did not preheat the lid just to make this part easier. And now back into the oven. So we bake in a Dutch oven with the lid on initially. So we have tons of moisture in the dough. That moisture gets released and into steam, and then the Dutch oven traps it. So we create this kind of hermetically sealed environment with lots of moisture for the dough. We take the lid off and it finishes baking. It takes on its beautiful color. Okay, so 20 minutes later, I'm going to take the lid off of the top Dutch oven. Be very careful because it's 500 degrees. Ooh, it looks so beautiful. All right, cannot wait. Oh, I love it so much. Okay, So I like to bake my loaves pretty dark. I want like lots of caramelization and color on the outside. I like a really well-developed crust. So the doneness level is really up to you. I go very dark. This looks perfect. Ooh, and here it is. Here's loaf number one. I see tons of little blisters on the outside of the dough, and I love seeing that. That's a sign of a really well-fermented dough. I like to pop them sometimes. It's kind of fun. So unfortunately, we have to wait as it cools. There's all this steam inside, and that steam is making its way to the outside of the loaf. As it happens, the crust will actually soften, and then once it cools, it will re-harden again. So I don't want to cut it because then all the steam is just going to escape. It's going to dry out. I mean, as much as I love warm bread, and believe me, I love warm bread, you do want to let it cool completely, so it'll take a couple hours. They expanded so differently, and like the shape is so different. Even though it's the same dough, same proofing basket, same shaping technique, they're both beautiful in their own way. Very, very pleased with the results. Every time I cut into a loaf, I get really excited because I'm so curious to see how the interior looks. It had a really nice oven spring. I love how tall it got. Like, there's some nice openness in it. I'm always looking for various sizes of holes and bubbles, and it just, like, I'm super excited to eat it. It's gonna be so good. Like, it doesn't get any less thrilling the more I make it. I don't even know where to start. I'm gonna try the grilled cheese, let's be honest. It's so, so good. One of the things that I appreciate most about making your own sourdough is the contrast between that super crispy and crusty exterior and the soft, like, springiness of the interior. I know that you can go to the store and buy sourdough bread, and I know that you can probably go to your local artisan baker and buy a very good loaf, but that's not really the point. The point of try this at home and making sourdough is that it's more of a practice. It's something you can do over and over again and learn a lot from, and I find it super rewarding, and I hope you do too. So try this at home, and thank you for watching. Ooh, why don't I eat more grilled cheese? I don't know.